Shabbat shalom, everyone. It is good to praise the Lord and make music to His name. Amen?
Amen.
And that's from Psalm 92, the only psalm that was written for the Sabbath day. And it is a great honor for me to be here this morning and be able to talk about a hot topic, I guess. Where is America in Bible prophecy? Well, it's not mentioned in the Bible, so goodbye. No. So, it's very easy to kind of dismiss that because obviously America is not mentioned. America is a new country. The word or the name America is a feminized Latin version of the name of Amerigo Vespucci, which is the founder or the Italian explorer, the cartographer who proved the existence of a new world completely separated from Asia. So Amerigo, America, that's where it come from, that's what it's all about. So you won't find it in the Bible. However, the name America, not just that it's not mentioned in the Bible, it's not the only country that we live today in the modern world, and we see that is not mentioned there. Many more modern countries nowadays are not mentioned by their current name. Russia, Turkey, Iran, Sudan, Libya, Jordan, these countries are not mentioned in those names in the Bible. Well, we know that they are in the Bible, and therefore, I wouldn't conclude that because the word America is not in the Bible, therefore, it has no role in Bible prophecy. In order to tackle the role of America in Bible prophecy, we first have to understand what Bible prophecy is all about. Because it's not about the pilgrims, and it's not about the Tea Party, and it's not about resettling the West. And it's not about that. You have to understand the first ever Bible prophecy given in the history was in Genesis 3:15 regarding the snake, regarding Satan himself. You remember about how he will be crushed by the hill. And then who's going to do that? The seed of the woman. So take the topic of Bible prophecy all the way to the very beginning, and you understand that the problem that the world has is actually Satan's being on the defense ever since that prophecy was proclaimed. Who is the seed of that woman? How can a woman have a seed? Obviously, it refers to Isaiah 7, verse 14, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive," and we know that his name will be Emmanuel. Who is Emmanuel? God is with us, if not Yeshua, Jesus himself. So prophecy was given first and foremost to warn the enemy that his end is coming. Amen? Okay, so And it's generally about Jesus being the one who will bring an end to that one. And we have to understand that ever since Genesis 1, in verse 28, when he talks about God's dealing with Adam and Eve, the Bible says that it will be his blessing, multiplied seed and land inheritance. And it was a foreshadow of the future of Israel. And that's why in Genesis 17, verses 1 through 8, God is reviving that plan through Abraham, blessing him, blessing him with seed and land. And these are the three components that appear in the Abrahamic covenant as well. So you see, we try to understand what Bible prophecy is all about. We go back to Genesis and we see how God is dealing with mankind, starting from Abraham. And then, of course, the fall of man and the flood, and he revives that same plan through Abraham with the same three components. It's very interesting to note that before he even addressed Adam or Eve, he first spoke to the serpent after Adam and Eve sinned in the garden. And once that prophecy had been set forth, the beginning of its fulfillment became the next act. And as I said, Satan was immediately placed on a defense. And so ever since Genesis 3:15 and for 4,000 years onward, the enemy has tried to finish an impossible task, which is to cut off the seed of the woman. And the reason why I say that in a message in America is that we're going to see how the enemy always use superpowers in the world first to maybe like the seed of the woman and then come against it. It's interesting how the enemy has tried to stop Messiah from coming forth, and he failed big time. The enemy tried to stop church through persecution, and he also failed. And of course, his next tactic was to infiltrate it. And this morning, Pastor Mark made it very clear how the apostasy is crawling into that into the church. And so you see, the enemy is trying to somehow cause the seed of the woman not to exist. What did Cain did to Abel? Nothing. What did Pharaoh try to do to all? What did Cain did to Abel? Killed him, obviously. Abel did nothing to him. What did Pharaoh try to do to all the male Hebrews when Moses was born? Obviously, kill them all. What did Haman try to do to all the Jewish people in the time of Queen Esther, if not kill them all? What did Herod try to do to all the Hebrew males at the few years after Jesus was born? Of course. So you see that the enemy not only was trying somehow to suppress this whole seed of the woman from, you know, coming to the world, but once he came to the world, he wanted to get rid of him. And it's interesting because the enemy, even today, is trying to suppress and oppress and ultimately attempt to eradicate the nation of Israel. But of course, he will fail again. Amen? So you see, first of all, we don't want Jesus to be even born. So we try to cut off the whole thing, the whole lineage, so he won't even be born. And then when he's born, we try to kill him. And then when he's not dead anymore, so we try to make sure that he's recruited to the side of Satan. And then when he's not there, then we try to stop him from dying on the cross. That's why Peter was told by Jesus, "Get behind me, Satan." And then, of course, when he was on the cross, he finished the job, the resurrection came, and now let's make sure that the people will not believe in it. Of course, the attempt to destroy Israel is so Jesus will have nowhere to come back to, because according to Bible prophecy, he has to come back to the people of Israel and to the land of Israel, and his feet shall be standing on Mount of Olives. So Daniel chapter 9 verse 24, we have the whole plan of God in regards to the people of Israel and to Jerusalem. Israel and Jerusalem are the things that Bible prophecy in regards to the events of the world are concentrated all around. And therefore, think about it. All the Bible prophecy in the entire book is either about Israel, the enemies of Israel, the God of Israel, or the Messiah of Israel. Amen? This is what it's all about. So I'm not going to sit here with you or stand here in front of you and teach you about other things in regards to Bible prophecy that are completely disconnected to the nation of Israel and to the city of Jerusalem. God of Israel and the Lion of Judah are in that center. So in Daniel's 70 weeks, there is the whole plan that God gave to Daniel. Interesting, Daniel was not even dealing with that. He was looking forward to that blessed hope, as far as he was concerned, to return back to Jerusalem at the end of the 70 years diaspora in Babylon. And God revealed to him something far greater. And we see that we live in that very big white gap before the last week that is about to come upon the people of Israel, because the prophecy is about Israel and about the city of Jerusalem. Of course, Babylon was the first superpower in the world that wanted to destroy Israel as a country of the Jewish people. Before that, when we talk about the Egyptians and when we talk about the Amalekites, Israel didn't have a land yet. But now they're in the land, this is them, they're in Jerusalem, and a superpower, world superpower that is hundreds of miles away from them is coming to destroy them. And that Babylonian spirit continues ever since throughout the generations. And we can see that. Jeremiah the prophet was a very bold prophet. He actually was bold enough to stand before his own nation and tell them, submit to the yoke of the Babylonians and live. You'll not make it. Your revolt against the Babylonians will not hold water. But of course, he was not a big and popular prophet. Unlike today, everyone who calls himself a prophet is a very, very popular person. That's why I say I am from a non-profit organization. But I want you to know that Jeremiah not only had the guts to stand before the people of Israel and tell them that they are barking up the wrong tree, but also to stand before the Babylonians and say, you are about to be destroyed, just so you know. And so Jeremiah was the one who set forth the end of Babylon, according to the word of God. So the question is, for all of us, is where is America? Not in regards to just Bible prophecy, prophecies surrounding Israel and Jerusalem, in regards to Israel and Jerusalem itself. Because this is how God eventually, according to the book of Joel chapter 3, is going to judge all the nations of the world. I'm going to bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I will enter into judgment with them on the account of my people, my nation Israel. And also they divided my city. So we see that after the Babylonians came the Persians, and after the Persians came the Greek. And just so you know, normally, those superpowers first really liked the Jewish people. They really liked Israel. Just so you know, Alexander the Great, upon entrance into Jerusalem, was actually introduced to the high priest. He was led to the temple, and he was shown the scroll of the prophet Daniel, where Daniel in chapter 10, verse 20 says that the king of Greece is going to defeat the king of Persia. And can you imagine? He's the king of Greece. And he just defeated the king of Persia. He felt that that book and these people are something completely different. They are very unique. And he actually ordered to protect them and to help them. And of course, the enemy crawled in, and the poison of anti-Israel, anti-Semitism, and the will of the enemy to cut off the seed of the woman crawled into the successors of Alexander to the point that they even desecrated the temple and slaughtered a pig on the altar. And it took them, to the Jewish people, 8 days to clean up, and that's why we celebrate the Feast of Hanukkah. So that's the Greek. And after the Greek, we're talking about more nations that came and controlled this part. Rome came. Do you know that when Pompey, in the year 65 BC, when he entered Jerusalem, he was shocked to see for the first time in his life a temple that does not contain a single statue. And he was blown away by it. He actually ordered to supply help to the Jewish people rather than to destroy them. But even Rome, we know what happened. After a while, they were those who destroyed Jerusalem and even the temple. And after that came the Byzantine Empire, and it was, of course, from Europe and on. And then the Arabian invasion in 638 AD. And believe it or not, the Muslims in the very first stages of their conquest of the land liked the Jewish people. In fact, the Muslim caliph asked a Jewish man to show him where the Jewish temple was, and this is where he wanted to build the Dome of the Rock, exactly on the same spot. From research that we did in Islamic history, we found out that the very beginning of worship in the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem was actually an assimilation of the worship in the temple done by the Jewish people. I mean, they were that much intrigued by the way Jewish people at the time worshiped God. In fact, they protected the Jews by saying that they are Ahal el Kitab, the people of the book. Don't touch them. Only after the Crusader era, towards the modern era, Jews were declared as infidels. But in the very beginning, they were actually more than the rest of the infidels. Then, of course, there is the Ottoman Empire, the Turkish Empire. And I want you to know that they also benefited from the Jewish people. Sultan Bayezid II, who ruled the Ottoman Empire from 1481 to 1512, welcomed the Jewish expelled from Spain under the Alhambra Declaration, resettling them throughout his empire and in Istanbul, Thessaloniki, Izmir, and all of that. And he even, to ensure their safety, he issued a decree stating that those who ill-treated or harmed the Jews would be sentenced to death. Not only that, he wrote or said to the king of Spain regarding the Jewish people, "You venture to call Ferdinand a wise ruler, he who has impoverished his own country and enriched mine." He realized that bringing the Jewish people to his place was actually an enrichment. Of course, even later on, when the European empires took over, they benefited from the Jewish people more than anything else. Towards the very end, even the UK was very friendly with Israel in the very beginning when the Balfour Declaration was given in 1917, and we celebrate 100 years of that this year. So just, I want you to understand, most great world superpowers or empires started well with Israel, but then the will of the enemy, the will of that diabolic, satanic spirit is to cut off the seed of the woman. You have to understand, they cannot reverse history right now. They cannot take back that which already happened, but they think they can at least stop that which may happen in the future. So destroying Israel is their attempt, their poor attempt, to somehow not cause Jesus to come back to his own people. Right after England finished its battle in World War II, it was evident that the mantle of superpower status was now moving to America, the United States of America. The door into a major role in Bible prophecy was actually open to the United States of America, and we could see the rise to a superpower position and the ashes of all the other empires that came up against Israel and were eventually destroyed. Isaiah 66, verses 8 and 9. Can a nation be born in one day? Can God bring Zion to deliver and shut her womb? No, of course not. A nation was born in one day on May 14, 1948, when Israel had two choices. Bad one and worst. The bad one is to declare statehood and suffer a war. Worse is not to declare statehood and suffer a war. They chose the first one. They declared statehood. And just in the hours before, in the corridors of the White House, there was a great, great tension between the President of the United States, Harry Truman, and George Marshall, the Secretary of State. Believe it or not, if it was up to the State Department of the United States of America, Israel should have not been created as a state. And they were fighting. And of course, thank God, in America, at least the president has the last word. And we can see that today. Everybody can see that today. This is what Little Rocket Man understands right now. He understands that there's someone crazier in the White House than he is. But you understand, Isaiah 66, look at what Harry Truman signed on. They didn't even know the name of the state of Israel. Nobody had a clue what the name of the country is going to be. So what they did, they said that it's a Jewish state that has been proclaimed in Palestine, and recognition has been requested by the provisional government thereof, and the United States recognized the provisional government as de facto authority of, look what he said originally, of the new Jewish state, because they didn't know the name. And then they crossed and say, the State of Israel, and who is signed? Harry Truman. That's Bible prophecy. That's Isaiah 66. And this is where America started playing a major role in how God is dealing with Israel. But believe it or not, Years went by, and you could see that things are not exactly falling in the right place. 1973, Israel was attacked on its holiest day in its calendar, Yom Kippur. We just had it last Saturday. And that day, on October 6, 1973, was an amazing day. Just so you understand, we almost gave up. Golda Meir had already enough medicine not to stay alive should the enemy come all the way to the prime minister's office in Jerusalem. Believe it or not, that's how bad it was. And when we asked for help from the State Department, the U.S. Jewish Secretary of State, Henry Kissinger, told Golda, or told the others, let the Israelis bleed a little. And believe it or not, Golda is a tough woman, you know, just like Jan. I mean, he doesn't take any no for an answer. And she picked up the phone, she called the White House, she woke up Henry Kissinger at 3 a.m., and she told him this, Mr. President, if in the next few hours America is not going to come and help Israel, we will not be there anymore. And what we know is that Mr. Nixon you just woke up at 3 a.m., and then he said, Golda, I want to tell you something. When I was a little boy, my mother used to tell me Bible stories. And one day, in the middle of Bible reading, she said, Richard, I want you to promise me that if you ever get to the point where you can help save the Jewish people, promise me that you will do so. And as a kid, I said yes. And now, maybe for the first time, I understand why I became President of the United States of America. And I want you to know, America's resupply included 815 total sorties, bringing Israel 56 combat aircraft and 27,900 tons of munition and supplies. That's it. We were able to push back and survive. So don't tell me America is not in Bible prophecy when America played a significant role to have Israel survive. But the erosion continued. And in the 1970s, the national security advisor to Jimmy Carter, Zbigniew Brzezinski, a Polish-American diplomat, wrote in his own book, look what he said. He said, the nation state as a fundamental unit of man's organized life has ceased to be the principal creative force. International banks and multinational corporations are acting and planning in terms that are far in advance of the political concept of the nation state. Basically saying, we need to start getting used to the fact that states are passé, and we need to be introduced to a new system, a new world order. After Jimmy Carter, we know that Reagan was there, and he was one of the best presidents, at least to Israel. Just so you know, during his time in 1981, Israel destroyed the nuclear reactor in Iraq. A French reactor that has almost become active. But I want you to know something. You guys were about to sell F-16s to the Shah in Iran in 1979. Well, what happened is the Shah fell, Khomeini took over, and now you got stuck with an order that nobody wanted. So we offered to buy it half price. That's what I call Jewish deal. And we got your birds, and we guarded them, and we put our own systems in them, and we flew all the way to Iraq in a shape of a large commercial airplane. That's how the raiders saw it. We destroyed the nuclear reactor. We came back home. The State Department was furious that we used American-made planes, and Ronald Reagan smiled and said, "Show me the pictures of what the boys did." But after Reagan, we had someone called George H.W. Bush. Am I right? Yes. And as early as May 22, 1989, U.S. Secretary of State James Baker had told AIPAC that Israel should abandon its expansionist policies And that remark took many as a signal that the pro-Israel Reagan years were over. And after the Gulf War on March 6, 1991, President George H.W. Bush addressed Congress in a speech often cited as the Bush administration principal policy statement on the new order in the Middle East and the rest of the world. And it's no longer Israel as something that they favor or like or wish to help. Actually, Israel is now standing on its way. Take a look at what America moved into with George Bush the father. Let's see it right now.
Certain that we stand at a defining hour. Halfway around the world, we are engaged in a great struggle in the skies and on the seas and sands. We know why we're there. We are Americans, part of something larger than ourselves. For two centuries, we've done the hard work of freedom, and tonight, we lead the world in facing down a threat to decency and humanity. What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order, where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause to achieve the universal aspirations of mankind, peace and security, freedom, and the rule of law. Such is a world worthy of our struggle and worthy of our children's future.
That's what he said to Congress on that very thing, just so you know. And then, of course, immediately he called to convene the Madrid Peace Conference, and you can clearly see, we can move on, and let's see the next one. This is our Prime Minister in 91, Yitzhak Shamir. Guess who is sitting behind him? Young Benjamin Netanyahu, or the Israeli ambassador to the UN at that time. And look at how serious Shamir's face are. The Americans not only didn't allow him to retaliate during the Gulf War to 39 Scud missiles, but pushed him all the way to Madrid to start talking about dividing the land between them and the Palestinians. And if that's not enough, Slick Willie continued that same thing, and in 1994, you can clearly see how he forced the arch-terrorist Yasser Arafat to shake hands with a war hero, Yitzhak Rabin, and led him to believe that this indeed will be peace, but it was nothing but peace by peace. And if that wasn't enough, after him came George W. Bush, who did not stop from efforts to bring about two states, and he had the roadmap for peace. He brought Ehud Olmert and Mahmoud Abbas almost to a deal that was eventually rejected by them. But I think that the culmination of everything came with Obama's administration, when he came all the way to Cairo and gave a speech, and in his speech he said, "All of us have a responsibility to work for this day when the mothers of Israelis and Palestinians can see their children grow up without fear, when the holy land of the three great faiths is the place of peace that God intended it to be, when Jerusalem is a secure and lasting home for Jews, Christians, and Muslims, and a place where all the children of Abraham to mingle peacefully together, as in the story of Israel, as when Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad, peace be upon them, joined in prayer." The United States president is quoting a story from the Quran about how Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad joined in prayer. So you see one that is actually listening to Bible stories from his mother and was convicted to help Israel, and another one who's listening to Quran stories from who knows who, and he's acting upon it. But the problem with the Obama administration was not only that he was so against Israel, but the world elevated him to something much more than you can ever imagine. I hope this video might work with the audio regarding something that was said about him in a music award ceremony that was held in Las Vegas, of all places. Can we see it, please? I don't know if you...
First of all, give an honor to God and our Lord and Savior, Barack Obama. Obama. Y'all stand up right now. You got to.
So when you get to a point where your president is now being held as the Lord and Savior, whatever he does is actually from God, and it's no longer an act of man. And you have to understand that. And we clearly saw the erosion in every aspect of life in this country, but also in the support in Israel between 2008 and 2016. Politically, he lost almost all credit in the entire Middle East. He was betting on the wrong horses when it comes to Libya, when it comes to Syria, when it comes to Iran, when it comes to Egypt. Every mistake was greater than the one before. All of his allies disrespected him, and that is an understatement. But not only that, spiritually, we're talking about a great attack on the American church and all over the world. Christianity was placed on a defense. And I was thinking to myself, Barak and Balak, two different kings in a sense, that understood that in the physical they may not be able to do much, so they have to move to the spiritual realm. And we know how Balak, the king of Moab, asked a curse to be proclaimed over Israel because he cannot really fight them in the physical realm. And so when the spiritual aspect is at its tackled, you see how everything is moving all even further down. Satan worship in America had become open and public everywhere. I just want you to know this is a website of the Church of Satan in America. Can you show that? You see that black picture of Baphomet, and this is a website. They have chapters all across the United States. They've been marching in the streets of the United States. They've been openly, publicly calling for Americans to worship Satan. In fact, move and see, no knee shall bow. Lilith, by the way, is a mythological figure of the goddess of fertility, in a sense. You can clearly see that it's no longer under the ground, it's above the ground. And just so you know, Satan's church headquarters is in the area called Hell's Kitchen in Manhattan, which is also known as Clinton. I just found it interesting. I want you also to know that morally, America declined even further and further throughout that time. Just a few examples. America has the highest STD infection rate in the entire industrialized world. In Chicago, public school kindergarten teachers are now required to set aside 30 minutes for sex education. The United States has the highest teen pregnancy rate in the entire industrialized world. Law enforcement officials estimate about 600,000 Americans that are trading dirty child pictures online. It is estimated that 89% of all pornography is produced in the United States of America. America has the highest divorce rate in the world by a good margin. America has the highest percentage of one-person household on the planet. At this point, approximately one out of every three children in the United States lives in a home without a father. In a massacre that is almost unspeakable, more than 56 million American babies have been slaughtered in that country since the Roe v. Wade was decided in 1973. The United States has the highest abortion rate in the Western world. Planned Parenthood founder Margaret Sanger once said, following, the most merciful thing that a family does to one of its infant members is to kill it. Planned Parenthood receives hundreds of millions of dollars from the federal government every single year. The FDA is actually considering making it legal for doctors and scientists to create three parents' babies in the United States. The number of active members of the U.S. military that kill themselves each year now exceeds the number of that dying in a battlefield. It goes on and on. I have a list of hundreds of those things. And I don't want to depress you, but I just want you to understand where we got to. And then, of course, comes the election of last year, and we were here a month before, and let's face it, the world was convinced that Hillary Clinton is about to win the elections. Wait, well, no, we're not political here. We're not. And I just want you to know that she was supposed to win. In other words, as far as the establishment is concerned, she was already the president of the United States of America. I've seen the Newsweek with her on the cover and with the entire interview of how she made it to become president of the United States. I want you to see Julian Assange in his interview a month before the elections, when he was asked about the chances of Trump to ever win the election. Look what he said.
My analysis is that Trump would not be permitted to win. Why do I say that? Because he's had every establishment offside. Trump doesn't have one establishment, maybe with the exception of the evangelicals, if you can call them an establishment. But banks, intelligence, arms companies,
well, they all want him
beat, foreign money, etc.
Yeah.
Is all united behind Hillary Clinton.
The establishment was shocked, and evangelicals back Donald Trump in record numbers despite earlier doubts. Not only that it was an accident, a big accident to the establishment, but the establishment needed to do a recalculation. And that accident called Donald Trump was already manifested in ways of his first visit to the Middle East. He came to Jerusalem. He didn't care what the State Department says, that a president that is seated is not allowed to go to Jerusalem to pray at the Wailing Wall because this is a disputed territory. He went all the way, placed a prayer, and did not wail at all. So what is the present situation right now? The door right now, as a result of the accident, the door out of a major role in Bible prophecy is coming. Because America is no longer playing to the music of the Pied Piper, and America is no longer pushing for the globalization. America is now officially into nationalism, not globalism, and therefore they had to shift their efforts elsewhere, and that's the next message that we're going to have today. And the Babylonian mantle of having to destroy Israel but first be liked by them, the Babylonian mantle of causing world government to do that, the Babylonian mantle is now moving back to Europe from America, and I believe with all of my heart that we are seeing that coming very, very quickly. And it's interesting because if America is moving away and fading away from its role, then what about Israel standing alone? Of course, Israel needs to survive. And it's interesting how God made sure that Israel will get to that point. Think about it. A small country in the size of New Jersey in the middle of such a chaotic place. And what about water, which is the most essential thing that you need? Ladies and gentlemen, this is from May 13. Israel is a regional water superpower. Israel is the world's leader in water reclamation, with 87% of its wastewater undergoing purification and reuse for agriculture. Guys, we have a mobile unit that can actually desalinize the waters of the Mediterranean from the sea to your cup, to your glass, and you can drink it within 2 hours. I want you to know, if that's not the only thing, energy. God made sure that Israel will not even have to rely on other countries when it comes to energy. We found hundreds of trillions of cubic feet of natural gas off the shores of the Mediterranean. We find more and more and more. We even found oil on the Golan Heights, but we really don't know how to get it because it's too deep and in such an angle that we say, we have enough over there. Let's deal with it later. If that's not enough, look at the world's highest solar tower. Look at it in the middle of the desert in Israel. We can generate so much energy just from the desert. Just speaking of water, Israeli company managed to come up with a way to extract water from the air, just so you know. Food. While farm workers made up only 3.7% of the workforce, Israel produced 95% of its own food requirement. Isn't that amazing? By the way, the Israeli cow are known as super cows. Israel cow are the world's most productive cows in the world. Every moo is computerized. Military-wise, rated number one in the Middle East with that many things that you don't need to look at. Why, look at this from news, why Israel has the most technologically advanced military on earth. By the way, this is from January 29, 2000. Can we move one more? You can see it. And then as we move on, five big reasons Israel is a mini military superpower. What about a technological advantage? How Israel became a cybersecurity superpower. It is an amazing thing. What I want you to understand is God made sure Israel will be okay the day after America. Do you understand that? Now, how did God use America to fulfill Bible prophecy? As a superpower, America's policy actually affects every single country that you see on this map to the point that they will come eventually and play a significant role in what the Bible says in Ezekiel and in Isaiah and all of that. So it was America that was placed as the current superpower that affects every single country that you see here or organization that eventually will come up against Israel. So what are the four possible scenarios that will cause America to step down from world stage as a superpower? Because you know what? Yes, I don't see America in the Bible. I don't see the name America. Some suggest that the young lions of Tarshish from Ezekiel 38 are America, which is very, very possible. But even there, you see that America is only somehow criticizing the attack but doing nothing about it. So what's going to happen to America? Why is America will be completely paralyzed at the time? Well, there's an option of a war from the outside. You know, everybody's thinking and calculating every single word that Trump just said yesterday about the calm before the storm. And Rocket Man is sweating right now because he doesn't get it. And then, of course, there's the war from the inside. I want to tell you something. I've never seen a country so divided in my life as I see right now. Now, make sure you understand, division is hard, but actually it comforts me, because you are still in the place where you fight over kneeling or standing, where all other countries will kneel automatically. You understand that? The actual debate and the fight tells me there is still some sanity around in some people's minds. But it's all going to fade away. The division is hard, and there are too many elements within America backed up by multi-billionaires causing division, and they're causing some sort of almost a mini civil war. Another very interesting possibility is a one or many catastrophic natural disasters. You and I know that hurricanes just take place, but hurricanes happen in hurricane season. Sometimes they're bigger, sometimes they're stronger. But I want you to know that most geologists are bracing for something much greater than just a hurricane. There are several candidates, apart from Yellowstone, that is brewing like crazy right now. There is the Cascadian Mountains on the northwestern shores, that they estimate at least a 9 in the mega, in the scale of the Richter scale. And they're talking about the New Madrid Fault, which is in the center of continent America, and the San Andreas Fault down in Southern California. They are estimating a catastrophic earthquake that will not destroy America, but will paralyze its economy for a while and cause her to deal with its own problems. But of course, the most likely reason apart from the hoped one, is a financial collapse. And I want you to know that we've been witnessing over the last few months a transition of wealth out of America, done by the wealthiest families of America, in preparation for their new place back in Europe. So a financial collapse is something that is the most likely scenario of the four. But let me tell you something, there is one more, and it's the hoped for scenario. And I hope all of you here understand that this is the one thing we can hold on to, because the hope for is the blessed hope. And that is, of course, the rapture of the church. Think about it and imagine to yourself, when we're gone, what this country is going to look like. And this is why, after I encourage you with so many beautiful things, at this point, we need to remember who we are. The Bible says in Philippians 3, 20 and 21, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body. Yes, it's all lowly. Pinch yourself, it's bad. Take a picture of yourself from 10 years ago, you're dying, just so you know that. He will transform our lowly body that may be conformed to His glorious one, according to the working by which He is able even to subdue all things to Himself. In John 17, by the way, we're here. We're not there yet. There's a reason. John 17 recorded the prayer of Jesus. He never said, Father, please take them away from this world. No, He said, Father, I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one, that they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth, which is the word. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth. You're here for a reason and for a season. We are to preach the gospel, and therefore we also, since we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which is easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. So, in the meantime, while we're still here, let's occupy. Who then is a faithful and wise servant whom his master made ruler over his household to give them food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master, when he comes, will find so doing. So while we're here, instead of always watching the stars and the moon and the sky and thinking, when is the rapture coming? Actually, do the Father's business. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much that you have blessed this country in many, many amazing ways beyond description. But Father, we also know that that blessing by many leaders had been abused and by many people had been wasted. And Father, we know your plans, for you do not hide your plans from your children. We know what is coming up. And we choose today to hold on to that hope that we have. For we know that he who promised is also faithful. And we know that the day indeed is approaching. So we bless you today from the United States of America. We send our blessing to you, knowing that every good and perfect gift come from you, the Father of light. And we thank you, Father, for being our shepherd in this very dark world. We thank you that we understand who we are, what we're here for. Give us the endurance to run the race, so we fix our eyes daily on the author and the finisher of our faith, Yeshua, Jesus. Yevarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'yichunecha. Yisa Adonai panav elecha v'yasem lecha shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord shine his face at you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance towards you and give you peace, the peace that surpasses all understanding, that can only come from the Prince of Peace in this dark era, in this country. We thank you that we have that peace. In the name of Yeshua, Jesus. And all of God's people say,
Amen. Amen.